vais vous parler des crises anciennes qui ont affecté
la biosphère ancient crises that have affected the biosphere for many million years, 550 million years to be exact. Over that time, we've had five major crises and about 50 minor crises, one every 10 million years. This for 15% of the history of life, because 550 million years only represent 15% of the history of life. So there must have been crises before, except that the previous crises, well, we have nothing to testify about those crises because the sedimentary registry doesn't tell us anything, which means that life has adjusted. The history of biosphere was not an easy trip. It was long, but it wasn't easy and quiet. Over the 3,800 million years. What about today? Is there a new crisis announced? Would it be comparable to the past ones? What is the pertinence of the relevance of a comparison between the past and the present? What are the processes at stake identical? And today's biosphere fragility, is it comparable to the fragility of the biosphere in the past? So let us try to understand how the previous crisis took place. We're going to focus on the five major crises. I'm going to list them very quickly. You can see them on the left-hand side. Column, the stratigraphic column. The first one during the Ordovician time, the highest Ordovician time in the previous called Hirmensian, Devonian, Franian Familian limit. The following one, the most important Permian, Permian Trias, and the fourth one, highest Trias at the limit between Trias and Jurassic, and finally, Cretaceous. Cretaceous and tertiary, and this is the last one, the one during which dinosaurs appeared. On the right-hand side, you have the red arrows showing the five crises over a curve, showing the number of marine families that inhabited the planet between the primary era and the current time, the oldest one on the left, the most recent one on the right. The old crises, well, each one is a different case. If we look at the continent distribution, here we have three crises, Ordovician, Permian, and Cretaceous. We see that paleogeographical aspects were different in the Permian. In the middle, the continents were still grouped together in a single mass, whereas during the Cretaceous, they were already separate. In terms of eustatism, sea level, we find that most of the crises correspond to times during which the sea level decreased and the continental platform disappeared. Only one in the Devonian is a transgression period. Regarding water oxygenation, very often a lower oxygen level, dysoxia and even anoxia during the Devonian, water was very poor in oxygen. And climate, finally, which is the most important parameter, which has the greatest impact on biospheres. Climate conditions are different from one crisis to the next. So every crisis is a different case. On climate, let me insist, climatic events were alternating between hot temperatures and cold temperatures or cold temperatures and hot temperatures. And that is what destabilized the situation. When a meteorite hits the Earth or there is a volcanic eruption that impacts planet Earth, what happens? Well, particles are released in the atmosphere and the sky becomes dark. There is a sort of nuclear winter or night and the Earth's surface cools down. Then, fairly quickly, the greenhouse effect gases, which were released, do the contrary. There is CO2, sulfurs, and there will be a greenhouse effect, and the surface of the Earth will warm up. There is an alternating of cooling down and warming up. This is what happened probably, except in the Ordovician, which was probably an ice area. Now, here we have the fire of the Earth and the sky. Meteorites falling from the sky or volcanic eruptions, volcanic activity. For the Ordovician crisis, we have nothing. We couldn't find an event that matched the crisis. For the Devonian, we think there might have been a volcano eruption in Scandinavia.
But
for stratigraphic purposes, we don't know exactly if it matches the crisis. And then for the other crisis, we have volcanic activity in Siberia, Central Atlantic, or in India. Huge quantities of lava overflowing, several kilometers of lava on the surface of France released a few million years ago. And then for meteorites, we only have three meteorite impacts which match more or less the crisis episodes. So it's very difficult to generalize the theory. Now, if we focus on meteorites, we talk about meteorites all the time. It is something that the media love, but maybe it's nothing else, because there is very weak correlation. Only two crises for which we have a meteorite falling from the sky that matches the crisis between Triassic and Jurassic, and in the Canada. And in Canada, we have also the Cretaceous crisis hitting the Earth in Yucatan in Mexico with a huge crater of approximately 200 kilometers in diameter. But we have other meteorite falls which were reported and observed in the fossil registry, for which we have no crisis matching that meteorite falling from the sky. So the biggest impacts have nothing to do with the crisis. So a meteorite is not a sufficient, neither a necessary factor for a crisis to take place. What about the mechanisms? Here we have a very famous curve from 2003. Cotillo and Wren, matching the time of a crisis and the time of basalt floods. And we have basalt floods that match no crisis. So basalt floods is not a sufficient factor to trigger a crisis. And the condition for a crisis to happen every time would be that the Vilnian age would be the Vilnius age would be more accurately defined. We have to understand whether there is a correlation between the Devonian crisis and the floods. We have nothing for the Ordovician era. Well, this being said, it's a very ancient period, so one may easily imagine that the floods then disappeared in the subduction areas since that time. So we can't rule it out, and we have a fairly good correlation. In conclusion, the crisis is long, it's generally made of several phases, and it's a complex event. They're all different. Everything that impacts biodiversity is the climate, first and foremost, with triggering events such as meteorites coming from the sky, volcanic activity, but whichever the initiating mechanism, it is the climate that will impact the biosphere. Forcing factors are diverse, and volcanic activity is very often present. And finally, biogeography also plays a major role. The distribution of continents plays a major role in crisis. Now, if we come to the current crisis and we try to compare, this is a graph with an extinction rate of some animal groups, marine species, mammals, birds, amphibians, vertebrates. Over the last 100, 150 years, we have a rate of extinction in thousands of species over thousands of years. Paleontologists can produce this kind of curve. What are we looking at? We divide the time over the last 500 million years in slices of 1 million year, and for each slice, we looked at the percentage of species that had become extinct. And we find that, in average, over each slice, the extinction rate is 20%, approximately. And the five major crises in biodiversity, we have 80% of extinction rate. So if we extrapolate what we know for the extinction of current fauna, the things happening now, we would have 8,000% for mammals. This obviously is frightening, because 80% for a major crisis, 8,000% nowadays, that would be much, much faster. Well, of course, this must be taken with a pinch of salt. There might be mistaken figures. And also, what we're observing is an instantaneous speed, whereas the right-hand side curve provides average speed over millions of years. But still, the extrapolation is quite worrying, because even if we are wrong by two orders of magnitude, it means that we are at least going as fast as the ancient crisis. What about speed? Speed is very important. It's essential. the climate is changing and climatic changes is occurring faster, as we can see from on the right. And if we look at the species extinction, it takes between 10 and 100 years. Now, in order to make a new species, it takes 10,000 years. And the life cycle of species is 1 million years. So the real problem is the speed at which change is taking place. It's not the amplitude, but the speed. We have all the conditions, the ingredients for a major crisis. The lesson from the past is that all crises were multifactorial, and the current crisis is multifactorial, and the intensity is at least as high as the crisis in the past. Are we going towards a new structuring of the biosphere? The question has been asked.